Welcome to Analog Jones and the Temple of Film. I'm Steve.
And I'm Matt.
And we're continuing with our Tarantinoctober. And
we're ending it.
We're ending it, yes. Yeah, it's all over.
No more. We're never going to watch another fucking Tarantino movie. We're finished.
Ever. We're going to burn all of these.
Yep.
It's going to be the special feature at the end of this vlog, whatever this is.
We're finishing it up. And we are watching for Halloween.
From Dusk Till Dawn.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. I thought you were going to say something.
Nope, I had nothing. We're watching From Dusk Till Dawn.
This is just one as a kid. Renting as a teenager. I guess I wasn't a kid. You were a kid at this time.
I was a kid at this time, but I didn't see this movie till later. So,
my brothers and I wore this out.
Yeah, I saw this. I probably saw this when I was a teenager, when I got super into Tarantino stuff. After Kill Bill. So I was 13. So it was about like 2003, 2004-ish. I was watching this maybe. But when I saw pieces of it as a kid. I didn't like it because I didn't watch the whole thing and I didn't know what it was. I probably didn't get it to any of the monster shit yet, you know?
We watched this in a perfect fashion. We rented it. We had saw it. So this came out, 95?
96.
96. So I was freshman around there. It was either 8th grade or 9th grade, whatever. When did this come out in the theater? This came out January. So this probably came out around May, June at that time. So probably the end of the... Yeah, summer. I bet that's what it was. We rented it. No idea. I don't remember this in the theater at all. Even though it made... Off 19 million, made 59.
So it was a hit. Yeah, did well.
Did well. I don't think when I watched the trailers to this that they quite knew how to market this.
Yeah, because it's two movies. It's sort of the original version of Grindhouse. It's Tarantino and Rodriguez doing two movies together. It's a crime movie and then it's a horror movie.
Yeah, and when Rodriguez talked about this when he met Tarantino, he's like, oh, I really like your stuff. And they became friends. I don't know what point that was, but eventually he's like, I have a script that I think you should shoot. And Robert, I think they talked about it a little bit in the behind the scenes on this. This is my VHS. So you, Matt, did something that I think he should be punished for. You want to tell him what you did?
I watched this on DVD. I did not watch the VHS.
It's not a happy Halloween here anymore.
You know, I have this movie on the DVD because there's so many bonus features on it, and I eat that shit up. So that's why we're here with this.
Somewhere in this mess, it's in here. It might be in the other mess. But yeah, I know those special features. They're fantastic. They stuck in on the end of this, like maybe 10 minutes, and you realize that George Clooney is such a jokester.
Yeah. You can tell they're having a blast making this movie. Yeah.
And he's really good, before we get into the trailers and the video on this, he is just really good at being, like, jokey, but at the same time just, like, doing it very straight.
Yeah.
He's like, you know, you've got, who is he saying? He's like, the thing about Harvey Keitel is, like, he's always asking me for money, and then he's coming into my set, and he's asking me how to do things, and then he's just giving Juliette Lewis... shit. He's like, she always wants to rehearse our love scene, which is weird because we don't have a love scene.
No matter what George Clooney says, he was intimidated when he found out he's going to work with me.
Juliette's nice. She's always knocking on my door. You know, George, you know, you want to rehearse the love scene, you know, which is hard. And because, you know, there is no love scene.
He's desperate at this point, and he was willing. He's like, if you need to set me on fire, so be it. I want to be in your movie.
Yeah, like, and then she's trying to punch back, and she's good. She could do anything. But he's just the master at it.
Yeah, he's a good little shit. He's a good little shit.
He is such a good shit.
He's a star. He's a born to be a star.
Him and Brad Pitt, like, I love, because if you ever seen Brad Pitt behind the scenes, Brad Pitt is not a method actor at all.
No, he's just having fun, too.
He's just... And he can turn it on.
Yeah.
You condescend me, man. I'll fucking kill you, man.
Anyway,
Yeah, no, and so I guess some of the before we get to any of the juicy stuff here, the only like behind the scenes thing I know about the genesis of this movie, actually, Robert Kurtzman, the effects guy, wrote the original screenplay for this, and he gets story credit in this because they didn't use his screenplay, but he wrote this sort of original screenplay of the gangsters in a
going to vampire.
Strip club, strip club vampires, which. You know, Kurtzman's early 90s stuff that he was working on, like Demolitionist, not the Sharon Stone one, but the B-movie one. When he was doing that, you know, he was doing, like, low-budget, Roger Corman-esque B-movies, so that's what this would have been. But then when Tarantino took over the screenplay and rewrote it entirely, it became this thing.
Now, I had a little bitty segment of time when I was going through Robert Kurtzman stuff of his past in the 90s. And you could always tell there's a couple movies. Maybe we can do those someday.
The Kurtzman stuff?
Yeah. But I don't know how we're going to get those VHSs.
Well, Wishmaster's pretty easy to find. Demolitionist is very hard to find.
I've got Wish... Okay, I think I have Wishmaster 2, which...
Yeah, that's like
it's weird.
Yeah, that movie sucks.
But why do I have two? I bet I bought two going, one day I'm going to own them all in VHS. Yeah. Like, I have Warlock up there, all three of those.
Yeah.
And this is funny. That's one of your favorite. I have all three Warlock. I've never seen them.
Oh, we got to watch
We've talked about this.
We got to watch the second one. Yeah. It's a fucking masterpiece.
I own them one day, but I have to watch them with you.
Yeah, I'm down.
Because I just want to look over at your face being like, so good, right? So good.
Yeah. Love the first one. Love the second one. Third one's a piece of shit, but I'll watch it any day. But anyway, yeah. So we're going to play a little game.
We're going to play a game, yeah.
I have not seen the trailers on this movie because I watched the DVD. Because
but you should
I
probably explain features.
Oh, the cover. Yeah. Okay. Well, before we play the game.
Yes. I love it when we forget our format.
Every episode. We've only been doing this. We're probably on our 6,000th episode and we still know how to do it. But
I can't remember names and... Or format. I forget everything.
It's all right. Yeah. And I do a lot of drugs. All right. So.
Go ahead and continue. Continue, Todd.
So we have... Matt. Exactly. We got Tarantino and Clooney on the cover with the gun, the smoking gun. It says, From Dusk Till Dawn. It's explosive. It's thrilling. From Robert Rodriguez, from Quentin Tarantino, From Dusk Till Dawn. Smart to have it like from each of them.
What's the little sticker?
And we got a little sticker on there that says, Exclusive Behind the Scenes Interviews.
Yep.
You guys have probably seen this cover. This is a pretty common one. Mm-hmm. And if you don't know what this movie's about, it is an action extravaganza, according to Roger Ebert. It's nonstop thrills when George Clooney, Batman and Robin, TV's ER, and Quentin Tarantino.
Why would you do that to him? Don't put Batman.
He wasn't on a lot of movies at this time, so they had to pick what they had.
Just put ER and Roseanne.
Yeah. TV's ER and Quentin Tarantino, Pulp Fiction, stars the Gecko brothers, two dangerous outlaws on a wild crime spree. After kidnapping a father, Harvey Keitel, Pulp Fiction, and his two kids, including Juliette Lewis, natural born killers, we're bringing that one back from Tarantino Month, the Geckos head south to a seedy Mexican bar to hide out in safety. But when they face the bar's truly notorious clientele, they're forced to team up with the hostages in order to make it out alive. From Robert Rodriguez and Quentin Tarantino, the creators of Desperado and Pulp Fiction, From Dusk Till Dawn is an explosive action entertainment. Plus exclusive, never-before-seen interviews with hot star Clooney and filmmakers Tarantino and Rodriguez. Hip, funny, and smart CBS TV. I love this, too. I want to point this out. This isn't on any of the other ones. It says, visit Dimension Films on the internet, in all capitals, www.dimensionfilms.com. I love that, like, it's like, internet is a thing now.
You can go to other websites. It's amazing. They're like stores, but cyber. Oh, God. I loved it when they first came out with all these, places, Miramax and WB, all this, where they first started to introduce that they're selling stuff online.
Yeah, the online stores.
Yeah, your online source for merchandise.
Yeah, and they have like t-shirts and free shit that they give out at screenings as their fucking like things they were selling.
Where can you get the latest, hottest, and coolest word on what's new? Get online at Newline's eBuzz and sign up for your exclusive eBuzz now. Your direct line to Newline.
Let's play the game. You didn't watch the VHS because you are a sinner.
Yes.
That's okay. Now I'm going to try to torture you with these. Try to guess the first trailer. It is from 1995.
Okay.
It has an AKA title. And okay. The AKA title is The Shooter. Not the true title. That was the working title.
The Shooter. From 95 and it's a Dimension and yes. or Miramax yes. film.
Yeah. Tagline is, this time, the rules have changed. What an original tagline!
Is it... Does it have any kind of Tarantino connection to it?
No, no. It has a Rocky connection. One of the Rockies. I don't want to give it out too much.
A Rocky connection. One of the Rockies.
Mm-hmm. Another tagline is... Man, these taglines are so generic. No, he could trust no one.
He could trust no one. God, it's so vague. I have no idea.
Dolph Lundgren, Maruska Detmers, Hidden Assassin.
It is Hidden Assassin.
Never would have got there, ever. No, with generic title.
Even too. Generic title. Both titles, Hidden Assassin and The Shooter.
Yeah, no idea. Okay, I've never seen that, and I don't think I ever
Marky
will.
Mark should have been in one of these. He was in one of them. Wasn't it called Shooter?
Yeah, he was in Shooter.
That's for American men to watch.
Oh, yeah, I never saw that one.
They eat steak every night. And never die until, you know, they get shot.
By the shooter.
But they die heroically, saving President Trump. Oh, God. The greatest president.
Oh, now you're going to get the hate. You're going to get this video fucking taken down. It's coming.
No, we only get it taken down if we play a song.
Ah, word. Okay. Yeah, that's usually how it
that's
works.
That's how it works. Okay. Second one. It is part of a horror franchise.
Okay.
So you've got one of those. Started in the 70s.
70s. Okay.
Okay. But churned up, it's, you know, the 80s. It's known as an 80s one and 90s, I guess. It has two titles.
Okay.
Changed. One changed after, I guess, it came out. I don't know when.
Is this another Halloween?
Correct. Trailer?
Halloween 6, the origin of Michael Myers, and then it turned to Curse of Michael Myers?
Yep, correct.
We had that trailer. Yep. We had that trailer on Pulp Fiction as well.
They desperately tried to sell that movie.
Yeah, and it just, they couldn't even figure out how to make that movie, so that was a big old mess. But you know what? I'll watch that one over Resurrection any day.
Well, Resurrection. You know, I've only seen Resurrection once.
I've tried to watch it so many times. Like, I've actually watched that movie like an embarrassing amount of times, and I'm like, maybe it's not that bad. And then I get about halfway through it, and I'm like, fuck, it's so bad.
It really is.
Trick or treat, motherfucker.
Third one's a good one. Also a horror franchise.
Okay.
And I believe it started in the 80s.
Okay.
1996. It has had many, many sequels.
Is this a Children of the Corn movie?
Ooh, close.
Is it a Hellraiser movie?
Correct.
Okay, Hellraiser, this 95 Bloodline?
Got it! Nailed it! It's Hellraiser in Space.
Yep. I like that one. It's fun. It's a mess, but it's a fun movie.
And Adam Scott's in it, right?
Yeah, Adam Scott's in it as like a creep.
Angelique, let's make this clear. What you want is irrelevant. It's about what I want. After 200 years, you should know what those things are.
Last one. Another horror franchise.
Is it Children of the Corn?
Correct! But which one?
95.
96. This
96. This is either 4, 5, or 6. Am I right in that range?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I want to say... So 4 has Naomi Watts in it, so I don't know if that's this one. Is this 5?
The second name on the title...
The Fields of Terror?
...is Jamie Renee Smith.
Is this 5?
This is for The Gathering.
Ah, fuck.
Starring Naomi Watts. Now, this is the one where Jacob comes back, correct?
No, the Jacob's in 6, Jacob's Return.
Oh,
because that's the title of that one.
Oh, well.
I'm slowly going through. I'm only on 3.
You said this like a year ago.
And I'm slowly going through the
really
series.
It's really slow.
I'm also starting the Amityville series now, too. So, like, I'm just about to, like, dig myself into 2 holes at the same time.
That is done so many times because apparently Amityville Horror, you don't need permission.
It's now, I think as of, like, 2012 mm-hmm. or something like that, it's public domain.
They've been pumping them out, right?
Yeah, everybody has done one. I think I'm just going to do one. I should do. What if, like, this is the birth of me doing, like, an Amityville movie? Like, I said it here first, kids.
All we have to do is get a creepy house to shoot in.
Yeah, and then you buy stock footage of the actual house, which you can buy stock footage of the actual house. So we don't even need to shoot the actual house.
Even better, we look at the stock footage of the house and reshoot.
And it curses us. That's the plot of the movie. We watch an Amityville movie and it curses us.
Oh, no, it's a reality show where we're shooting the Amityville Horror and we die.
But I want to what if they're watching a reality show that's shooting the Amityville house and then they get cursed? I like this second layer here. Done. I think we're making
and
this
And we're watching someone watch.
The curse happen?
Yes.
Beautiful. Done. 3-layered Amityville movie. If in, like, 5 years you see me do an Amityville movie, you saw it here first, kids.
I want writing credit.
Yes, if the story
Because I'm going to help you write this script.
Yes, we're going to make an Amityville. The first Analog Jones movie. Or we're going to call it, like, Amityville 25 or something like that. Like, we're going to pretend it's in the actual franchise.
Yeah, because we can do whatever we want.
Because it's public domain now, so done. Done deal.
Oh, man. Okay. There's, No, that is it. But we did have a lovely, now available on CD and cassette, From Dusk Till Dawn, the soundtrack.
Music from the motion picture From Dusk Till Dawn, featuring ZZ Top, Stevie Ray Vaughan, Jimmy Vaughan, The Blasters, Tito, and Tarantula. From Dusk Till Dawn, the soundtrack, available now.
Yeah.
And then it said, stay tuned for bonus features.
Perfect.
Or I wrote bonus features and said, stay
bonus
tuned.
Bonus interviews, yeah, probably, yeah.
Never before seen interviews. Some shit like that. Oh, this is so great. So, feature presentation time.
And now, our feature presentation.
Right when it comes on, we get a shot of Michael Parks and...
Yes. John Hawks, also. Man.
Been one long, goddamn, hot, miserable, shit-ass fucking day every inch of the way. First off, Nadine over Blue Chip got sort of sick, so she got that goddamn mongoloid boy who's working the grill. I mean, that fucking idiot doesn't know rat shit from Rice Krispies. I eat breakfast by 9 o'clock, and I'm puking up pigs in a blanket like a sick fucking dog by 10:30.
Isn't there a law or something against retards serving food to the public?
Well, they ain't ought to be. I mean, who in the hell knows what's going on in the mind of a goddamn mongoloid? Nadine should have hit that boy in the head and sold the fucking milk.
Acting their asses off in their opening scene.
John Hawks needs to be in more.
Yes.
I know he's in, you know, he's been an actor for quite a long time. But this, he's great.
Yeah.
This is one of my favorite Tarantino and Avery starts of a movie.
Yeah.
It might be my favorite.
It's a great opening scene.
I know. Reservoir Dogs is really good too at the diner.
Yeah, but this is top notch.
I love this because not only this is talky-talky interesting, but it's pure action at the end.
You okay? He shot me in the fucking head! I told you he said help us! I never said help us!
Well, it doesn't matter now because you got about 2 fucking seconds to live. Richie?
Yeah?
When I count to 3, you shoot the bottles out from behind him.
Oh, yeah!
1.
Fuck!
2. 3.
Yeah.
And it makes a lot of sense to setting. You know the characters in 10 minutes.
Yep.
I don't need any more character blah blah nonsense telling me about their backstory. I know the Gecko brothers. Yep. Done.
Yeah. Like, yeah. You absolutely get it. And we of course get the amazing shot in the movie where they're walking away from the explosion but still having the Tarantino dialogue conversation. Yeah.
Like, that's an expensive shot, please get that right.
What did I tell you? What did I say to you? I said, buy the roadmap and leave.
What the fuck am I supposed to do, Seth?
Recognize this. He didn't recognize shit.
Seth, I'm telling you, the way he looked at us, you especially, I knew he knew.
Low profile. You understand the meaning of the words? Low profile.
Hey, Richie, how's your hand? It hurts like a fucking
slap. Let me tell you
Seth,
what low profile is not.
It is not taking those hostages. It is not shooting police. It is not setting fire to a building.
Yeah, and they nailed it. Like, they don't even flinch. He's just still talking as it explodes.
That shit had to burn.
Oh, yeah. That's they hot. Were hot. They were definitely hot.
I hope they put, like, stuff on the back of their necks and everything.
Yeah, they probably were protected. You don't. You got to protect Clooney if he's going to do your movie for you.
Yeah, I mean, there are certain parts where Clooney clearly is carrying Tarantino, like when they're like really close and he's like grabbing his head and everything like that. But this is a scene where almost part of me is just like, Tarantino's an actor. Like when they're walking off and they're having their arguments. Later on, Tarantino kind of dips down where I could see, me personally, I was starting to notice. But maybe that's partly because Clooney's Clooney.
Yeah, it's like, I've always heard people talk shit about Tarantino's acting, and I've never really thought, like, there's been a lot of worse fucking, like, directors that want to act in their stuff that are, like, terrible. Like, me included. Like, Tarantino's okay. He's not bad.
Take Back the Knife somewhere back there.
Well, I'm not in that one, and that's why it has distribution. Like, he's fine. He's fine. But, yeah, next to Clooney, who's fucking, like, rock star.
Oh, he's so good.
You're not going to get...
I want Clooney as a bad guy again.
I know. We need this again.
Anti-hero. Yeah. I don't know what he is. But I just love how he has to put up with his brother's fuck-ups.
Yeah.
Richard, what's wrong with you?
Before you flip out, okay, let me just explain what happened.
Yeah, explain it to me. I need an explanation. What is the matter with you?
Back into this. I forgot Kelly Preston had a little bitty scene in this.
Yeah, that's fun. Little it's
weird?
Yeah, it's just like a little cameo kind of thing.
Crime spree started just a week ago today. The oldest of the two brothers, Seth Gecko, was serving time in Rawlings, Kansas State Penitentiary for his part in the 1988 Scott City bank robbery in which two law enforcement officers lost their lives.
Tarantino kind of plays a really good freak.
Yeah, he's like creepy and weird, and like, because he like rapes the one they kid, but then kills her too, and he's like, I don't know, I couldn't help it, and it's like, ew, you're so gross in this. So, but he's good at it. He's good at being like a kind of a gross worm.
But the one that gets me is when Juliette Lewis looks at him and, you know, says her line, which I'll play.
Richie, would you do me a favor and eat my pussy for me, please?
Sure.
Richie, hey. Not when you get around to it. Now.
That, to me, when I first saw this, I thought she was like 16.
Yeah, and then she's supposed to be kind of like in the movie,
but she's actually like 22, 23.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He plays a good worm creep in this, Tarantino. You know, like, even if he's not the best actor in the world, but I'm saying that he's not that bad, he writes himself a good character for a bad guy.
Yeah, you realize Juliette Lewis went from, like, What's Eating Gilbert Grape to, like, you know, Natural Born Killers to From Dusk Till Dawn, Strange Days, and then Basketball Diaries. Like, she's...
All over the place.
She
versatile.
Was...
Versatile.
Yeah, and she was acting all the way back in the 80s, right?
Yeah, she was a kid actor.
Yeah.
I liked Juliette Lewis a whole lot.
Didn't she get nominated for an Oscar?
She might be for one of those movies. I don't know, but she might have been. She's great. I love Juliette Lewis, and she's great in this, too. Because she plays so well, sort of like, maybe like that 16-year-old girl, but then she's like the badass wielding the shotgun by the end of the movie.
Yeah, I know. She goes from like an innocent church girl to, you know, wielding a shotgun, wanting to hang out with the other Gecko brother.
Yeah.
Need company? Like, you don't want to go where I'm going. But, yeah, that's, I mean, then she fell off in the early 2000s.
Yeah.
She didn't make, but she's made a little bit of a comeback.
Yeah, she's popped up and stuff lately, and it's always good to see her.
I don't understand why she wasn't content. She's a little bit odd, I think.
Yeah, I think that's why people maybe have been intimidated to use her, you know? Because you know it's not going to be on her. It's going to be the people hiring.
Yeah.
Because they all want 20-year-olds actresses for everything. But like, she's great, and I think people are intimidated by her.
She also kind of made, later on in her career, she makes some odd acting choices.
Yeah, I'm thinking of that one where she plays like the handicapped girl.
I'm going to be a veterinarian's assistant.
Wow.
But to do that, I need a high school diploma.
I think the best thing for right now would be just to have a nice, big, long vacation, and we'll explore your options later.
I would like to explore my options now, Mother.
Yeah.
That one was like a bad choice.
I'm going to go over that one.
Yeah.
But no, I mean, honestly, she's just kind of... I think in the, you know, when she was in the 90s, she was in her 20s. She got away with it because she did so many edgy things.
Yep.
You know, everything was edge. And then, you know, that doesn't exactly flow right over to, like, more of the normal stuff when you get in your 30s and 40s that you're trying to make. And she's, you know, you can't have her as a mom.
Honey, quit picking at it. Are you nervous or what?
Yeah, a little. It's a pretty big school.
Well, first days are always a little goofy, but you and I are going to be fine. We are modern babes in a modern world.
Oh my god, how am I related to you?
We get further on into this where they find the family and they get across Mexico. And then we get introduced to Cheech.
Yes.
From
Cheech and Chong.
Yeah, Cheech and Chong. Cheech Marin?
Yep.
Yeah. His first character is playing in this.
Yes.
Because he plays three.
Yes.
And this one, he's a border agent when you're crossing into Mexico. And I love how he knocks out Tarantino. And then when he wakes up, when they're past, you know, into Mexico, he goes, I don't know what happened, man. You were saying some weird stuff, and then you just fell, and we got scared.
that's pretty great. And then we literally get him again as, like, the barker in front of the strip club when they get to the Twisted Titty.
Pussy, pussy, pussy! Yeah. Like, how he just keeps saying that. Yeah. Man, he says that. He says pussy so many times. I was trying. I'm like, 1, 2, 3, 4. I get to like 5, and I'm like, nope, I can't count past 10 because that's how many I got here.
Yeah.
That's it.
And I can't count, so like, at least you got further than I could.
I just remember at one time he's like, chicken pussy. I'm like, what?
Here at the Titty Twister, we're slashing pussy in half. Give us an upper on our best selection of pussy. This is a pussy blowout.
Like, advertising this bar to us, the audience. Like, he's talking, Cheech Marin is talking to us. And I mean, like,
that's
part of the fun of this movie. Yeah. Rodriguez doesn't care. He was like, I'll break the fourth wall for no reason right here.
If we don't have it, you don't want it. Something like that.
He said, if you can find it any cheaper, fuck it.
Yeah, that's it, yeah.
If you can find cheaper pussy anywhere, fuck it.
Is that the only time they break the fourth wall?
There might be something with the vampires.
Yeah, I thought the vampires.
I think there's a moment maybe with the band where they break the fourth wall, maybe. I feel like there's definitely something that happens when, like, the band is playing and they're playing, like, the body instruments of the mangled corpses. I think there's a moment where they look into the camera, too.
Well, right when they step into a bar, it's a new movie.
Yes, we're in a horror movie now. Yeah. We're in an exploitation horror movie.
That's fucking fantastic. I want to go in this bar. I don't know if they created this entire set once they walk in. I have no idea. I don't know if this is like some set that people
use
multiple times, but they walk in and it's fantastic.
Yeah, the set design's incredible. And the characters, like the costumes, like all the art direction stuff is so good in this movie.
And we get Greg Nicotero and Tom Savini. And I think the other guy at the table, too, is a special effects guy, but he's less known.
I think this is one of Tom Savini's best performances. I think he's good in this movie. As Sex Machine?
I didn't even know who he was when I first watched this. I just thought he was an actor.
Yeah.
So, good job. Same thing with the football player.
The Hammer? Fred the Hammer
Fred
Williamson?
The Hammer Williamson.
I love him.
Fred Williamson, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Which, by the way, his character's name is Frost.
Yeah.
I don't think they ever say his name, though.
Go! Monkey man. Anything you got to say to them? Say to me first.
One of the other ones that I think is really funny is Danny Trejo's in this.
Yeah, Danny Trejo.
And he's in, obviously, all...
Razor?
In all of the Rodriguez movies. But one like little piece of trivia that I thought was so funny is that his name in every Rodriguez movie is a knife. So that's why he's Machete. He's got another knife name in Predators. He's Razor in this. Everything is blade related.
Welcome to the Titty Twister.
Bottle of whiskey and five glasses.
Call me right on.
For his name in every Rodriguez movie.
I did not know that.
Yeah.
That's
a weird
really
piece of trivia I found.
And then Tom Savini's character is Sex Machine, which they say multiple times.
Yes, yes. And he's got the dick gun, which is amazing.
And I still don't know how that would work.
We're having a blast at this point in the movie. Because we get the Satanico Pandemonium kind of seduction scene with Selma Hayek, and then this shit gets crazy.
That Selma Hayek scene. I know girls that are like, that's like the hottest dancing I've ever seen.
Yeah, and she doesn't take off any clothes.
Did you notice this other strippers are wearing the same thing she's wearing? So they're very coordinated at this titty twister. I was like, they have a uniform for the strippers.
Yeah.
Except the strippers that were like dancing on the bar and stuff. They're like, those are the mid-level or the bottom-level ones.
Yeah.
They're not part of the group yet. They've got to make it.
They've
got
to work their way up to the Satanico Pandemonium outfit.
Yeah. Those are the shitty vampires.
Yeah.
But yeah. And it's funny, too, because they set up right when this, like, the shit goes nuts. Because, like, Gecko gets stabbed in the hand.
Yeah.
Because, that's right, Cheech's character comes back in. And he's like, he broke my nose!
Yeah. And then the big fight, and then the blood, and then the vampires.
But they kind of set up that Selma Hayek's character is, like, the leader. Because she's like, I'm going to make you my slave. You're going to lick shit off my boot. And Gecko, Clooney goes, no thanks, I've already been married.
Since you'll be my dog, your new name will be Spud. Welcome to slavery.
No thanks, I already have a wife.
By the way, so Hellraiser 3 kind of has like a crazy scene like this where they go crazy inside of a bar and just murder.
Yeah, blood everywhere, body parts everywhere.
Wishmaster has it, both of them look very cheap compared to this. Obviously, the special effects people are having a blast doing it, but they're not at the same level. This is how you do it.
Yeah, this is a bigger budget version of those scenes.
I don't know how much bigger of a budget, because they're...
It's true.
Their budget's $19 million.
I still feel like for this kind of movie, that's pretty big. Because Wishmaster probably like a $2 million budget. And like Hellraiser probably had like a $5 million budget.
Like
This is fun. There
this
are
is
body
where they spent
everywhere.
All their money.
Yeah.
You can tell. They're like, the rest of this stuff has been cheap up to here.
Yeah.
We're in an RV. We're in a hotel. We're in a bar. Maybe the explosion on the bar or the gas station. That probably cost money. But they saved up their money for the right time.
Yep.
And I feel like that's how you have to do it.
I love that scene.
Yeah, I love it. It's so good.
And I mean, from that moment on, the movie never stops. Because then you lessen the amount of vampires.
You get one more. You get one more when they get, after the dad gets bit, they go in the back.
Yeah, that's sort of the cave in the back,
like,
or whatever.
Give your audience a little time to breathe and kind of like
process
what the fuck just happened.
That's sort of the last time the movie stops, or the only time the movie in the second half stops, because the movie just rips from like the vampires on.
And the vampire turning speed makes no sense in this. Yeah. You don't hear a lot of people challenge this. But I will, even though I fucking love this movie. So you get Sex Machine, who takes a while to turn.
Mm.
He's like checking his fangs, which is really funny, by the way.
Who's
Tom Savini?
He does like the thing. Yeah.
But then
Fred the Hammer turns pretty quickly.
Frost turns really fast.
Yeah.
Who cares? Has a weird CG face.
I always say,
why didn't they go with all prosthetics? I don't get it.
I think it's prosthetics. It's just the change, like the because he's got prosthetics of just the teeth thing
there, but like the bats going by, him, and then like his face. There's some type of
There's some CGI there, but
I think it just would have been. I understand the bats. You have to do the bats.
Yeah, I get that. It's fucking ridiculous and awesome.
Well, and then doesn't also Sex Machine turn into like a giant rat bat?
Yeah, he's like a
Like a dog
thing. Yeah.
I don't get
I think it's a rat thing. I think you're right with, like, the rat thing.
It's almost like Greg Nicotero's like, well, I got this. I've been trying to get this into every movie. And they're like, stick it in!
Fuck it. I do love when I like show people this movie, because I've over the years, like in college, high school, even today, where I show people this movie, how hooked they get by it, because they'll stick with it for the first half. They'll be like, okay, it's like a Tarantino thing. I dig it. It's fine. Yeah, I like it. You know, maybe some like it more than others, but by the time this all happens, everybody's like all in on it. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, this is the crowd pleaser moment, or like. Anybody who likes the kind of weird shit we do is like, yep, this is amazing. I love this movie too.
I always love that because you can't tell them what it is.
Nope.
You set it up really well. What was that Italian, the kid with the incest?
Burial Ground?
Yeah. When you set it up, I'm not even going to spoil that one. You watch it.
Yeah, Burial Ground is fucking insane.
Watch it. But there's a point where everyone in the room goes, what the fuck? And this is what Dusk Till Dawn does. It's like right when they come in with the vampires, I've seen people who have never seen it, love watching this in a group, and they go, what the, what? Even, this is a vampire movie?
Even if they know it's a vampire movie, they don't know how fucking wackadoo it's going to get and how bloody it's going to get. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, they're like, okay, it's a gangster movie that turns into a vampire movie. Sure, I'll watch that. But then by the time the shit hits the fan in that scene, they're like, holy shit. Like,
well, and the courage, too. They kill Richie Gecko first.
Mm-hmm.
Then the dad gets bit. Mm-hmm. Then the kid dies.
Kid dies, yeah. Salma Hayek doesn't last very long.
No, she doesn't. You think she's the leader? Possibly the leader. Maybe.
Right, right. And then,
I think,
like,
Danny Trejo dies pretty quickly,
yeah,
too.
Danny Trejo dies very early on. We kill the one Cheech Marin pretty early on, too, when he turns. This movie has balls, you know?
I don't even think there is a leader vampire. It's just a...
No, by the time they kill kind of all the main ones, and then, like, at the end, it's just the cronies going after them.
Which is really funny when they, like, start, like, the father starts blessing the holy water, like, the balloons.
Yeah.
Or is it condoms? Is it condoms?
I think they're condoms, because it's this movie. Because,
of course. And then squirt guns full of holy water. Yep. And then you got George Clooney in another trailer moment where he has, like, the jackhammer.
The stake. Jackhammer stake.
Yeah.
Oh, my.
Oh, Oh, yeah, and the dad's got the shotgun with a bat making a crucifix.
Yep.
Yeah, that's...
So he's doing the cross, blowing him away. Yeah, it's great. And, it's great.
And one of the things we forgot to say is, like, Harvey Keitel's... he's a preacher who's lost faith because his wife dies.
Yeah.
And then, I don't know, at the end, he gets faith back?
He sort of, like, embraces the faith, but, like, he's still kind of a badass. He's not, like, you know, he doesn't, like... go to, like, be a pacifist or anything like that. He's, like, still, like, all right, I'm gonna fuck shit up, but, like, we need some help here, so I'm gonna call on my old buddy God here. Yeah.
And this is, when I watched this, this is before I got into my Scorsese phase. Martin Scorsese, I can't say his name right now. But I'd go back and see him in Taxi Driver, where he's, like, the pimp.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, he's been a badass in past. To me, he was just the... He's just an old guy.
Right. And he's sort of the first part of the movie. Yeah. And then you realize, oh, yeah, Harvey Keitel's like a motherfucker. Like, he's a badass guy.
Oh, he's such a good actor, too.
Yeah.
I just don't think my generation and this, you know, the generation afterwards, like, you don't really realize how good he is until you go back and watch his movies in the past.
We don't appreciate Harvey Keitel enough.
He's fantastic. He can literally do anything. Yeah. There's so many, like... George Clooney can do anything. Juliette Lewis can basically do anything. Harvey Keitel can do anything.
Yeah.
Like, there's the acting in this of the leads they're, you know, it's top notch.
There's a reason Tarantino has used Harvey Keitel so many times, you know, like, because he brings it fucking every time. Like,
he basically, didn't he use him, obviously, Pulp Fiction.
Reservoir Dogs. This. That might be it.
Was he in Jackie Brown? Did he have a small cameo?
No, I don't think he's in Jackie Brown.
Harvey Keitel then eventually retired.
Yeah, he doesn't work in, which is a shame because he's fucking incredible. But maybe someday.
I mean, let him enjoy his life. He's been doing it for a long time.
Maybe Tarantino will bring him back for like a really badass like old man role in something at some point.
I mean, if anyone's going to convince him, it'd probably be Tarantino.
Maybe because Tarantino keeps saying that his next movie is going to be his last movie, or at least for
a
while.
See.
Yeah, exactly. But like. If it is, he should really get the whole gang back together. We should have Harvey Keitel, Tim Roth, Uma Thurman. Like, everybody should be in this next one.
Hopefully. I mean, we'll see. We'll see what he can pull off. But, yeah, he's just worked with so many good actors.
And pulled some of their best performances out of them.
Yeah.
For sure.
The guy just knows how to write dialogue. Yep. And then he gets incredibly talented people to pull it off.
Yep. Yeah. I mean, I think with this year, he's given Brad Pitt and Leo DiCaprio two of their best performances. Easy. And when I think of my favorite Brad Pitt performances, they're all three are Tarantino performances. True Romance, Inglourious Basterds, and Hollywood. So, like, and then DiCaprio's best performance easily was Hollywood for me.
Get some cleaning products, man.
Don't you fucking condescend me, man.
Condescend me, motherfucker. I don't know what he says exactly there, but dummies. I just love how he says, motherfucker.
Yeah, he's so good. What a masterpiece that movie is.
I love True Romance. It's, to end this, they basically get out. He meets another Cheech character. I don't even know this person's name, but it's to get to El Rey.
Yeah, which is another through the two of them. They always use El Rey.
El Rey's always... He gets the Porsche. The girl's like, you need company? He's like, you don't want to come where I'm coming. Go home.
Doesn't this movie has a really good last line. What's the last line of this movie? I can't remember now. There's a really good last line of this movie. Whatever the last words are in this movie, it's something cool. Because it's Tarantino.
I just remember Clooney's like, you don't want to go where I'm going. Go home. Yeah, I don't remember.
No, but he says something. I'll
play it.
Maybe a bastard, but I'm not a fucking bastard.
And then, they go on to two more in a TV series.
Yeah,
which is fun.
I never watched the show, but I do like 2 a lot. I think it's a super fun movie. And 3's got some moments, but it's mostly boring. But it has some moments, so...
Season 1's good. I haven't watched anything. I mean, there's parts in Season 1 where I was like, ugh, this is a sci-fi television series or whatever. I don't know if it was sci-fi.
It was on El Rey. It was on, Rodriguez's channel.
That's right, that's right. Is that still around? Mm-hmm. Or is that? Okay,
they show Godzilla movies fucking all the time.
Fuck yeah, Godzilla. That's a way to keep it up.
Yeah, right? I mean, that's a way to get people to watch it. Yeah. If I see like
monster
one
of, films.
If I see a monster movie I like on El Rey, I'm going to switch over to it.
Ah, that's going to end it for this. Put something in the museum. Man, there's a lot.
Yeah, I mean, I think this movie's a masterpiece, and I love that it's like a horror masterpiece as well. I don't know, man. I guess I just put the gore in the museum. I just love the gore in this movie. It's out of control.
I'm going to put the line by Harvey Keitel when he says, "Are you such a loser that you don't know when you've won?"
That's a good line.
I love that line.
Yeah.
Are you such a fucking loser? You can't tell when you've won.
Great. It's great.
Telling of both of the characters, too.
Yeah, it's perfect. It's a perfect line. It's perfectly delivered, and I love to see... And I always love George Clooney when he's taking those shots. He's, like, smashing that shot glass into the table. I love that. George Clooney, never stop being George Clooney. And it would be fun to see Tarantino and George Clooney match up again, and Rodriguez.
Yeah, I'd like to see this.
Can we get the old, like, grandpa gecko brother?
Yeah, or just another character like this. Just another, because I'm sure they could write another great character like this.
Well, I want him to be a bad guy again.
Yeah, like, let's put Clooney as a bad guy. Let's get Rodriguez and Tarantino involved again. Let's make another grindhousey, because this is a grindhouse movie.
Yeah.
Another grindhousey fucking horror action thing. Let's do it.
Yep, that's going to end it for our... TarantinOctober. It's been fun and quite a ride.
Mm-hmm.
I wish all of these were on VHS so we could do them, but maybe one day we'll do non. I mean,
or a summation one, maybe, where we just look at everything past.
There's quite a bit. Do I have
Jackie Brown?
Do we have all the Tarantino stuff on? Are we missing something? Jackie Brown,
Reservoir Dogs.
Reservoir Dogs. No, I got
Oh, you mean just?
I mean anything.
You got Hateful Eight. You got.
No, I don't have Hateful Eight. That's why.
Oh, that's Django?
That's Django.
Yeah, Hateful Eight. Hollywood's not out yet, so we can't have that.
Yeah, I think that's the two I'm missing.
I mean, there's obviously, like, the stuff, like, the uncredited stuff, like the Crimson Tides and the Rocks and stuff like that, but I think the pure ones, we're looking at most of them here.
Yeah. Man, he's got quite a collection. Whew.
Yeah.
A lot of hours of my life are in these.
Yeah, a lot, because I have watched all these movies... Yeah. A lot of times. I've probably seen Death Proof and Pulp Fiction about 100 times each.
I didn't know you liked Death Proof that much, because I love it. I always try to sell people on it. But
yeah. Oh, I'm upset. My movie, Take Back the Knife, was just a gigantic fucking Death Proof ripoff. I just did it as a pure slasher movie instead of a car slasher movie. But it's a Death Proof ripoff.
Because car slasher movies are hard.
Yeah, like, I can't get a car. I can put Chase in a mask and have him chase people around, but I can't. I love Death Proof. I think it's a fucking another masterpiece of his in a catalog of masterpieces.
When he takes Rose McGowan and like looks at her and goes, "Going right or left?"
Well, you could have said you could have said right and you'd feel safe for a while, but you said left. We're gonna go right.
I love that movie. I can watch. I don't know why. I mean, I understand it is obviously slow. On parts.
But I can eat that dialogue up like fucking breakfast. So.
And I don't know. Did he had to have... I mean, because the girls like sitting in the group, that reminded me so much of my cousins when I would have rides with like 3 or 4 girls in a car. And the shit that would come out of their mouth, you'd be like, what?
Yeah, no, it's so honest. What? It's so honest.
I was like, how do you... Did you write... Those ladies.
He must know these like stunt women from working for so many years in Hollywood, and just hears how they talk, and you know, and wrote it down, and there it was. And God, what a fucking masterpiece that movie is. Yeah. But look, like I love Django, I love Pulp Fiction, I love From Dusk Till Dawn, I love Inglourious Basterds, I love Death Proof, I love True Romance, I love Reservoir Dogs. Of all the ones we're looking at, there's only kind of 2 questionable ones here. The rest are fucking all rock star movies. So good on you, Tarantino.
Good job. Yeah, god damn. That's a lot of good shit. We're going to end it with that right there. I think November Are we gonna do the Moonbeam?
Are we gonna do? I'm down for Moonbeam November.
Are you down for Moonbeam November?
I'm down. I'm definitely down for Moonbeam November. Four of those, I think, because I think it's a 4-weeker in
That's
November.
That's a 4-weeker, yeah,
so,
probably.
Yeah. So we got four of those. Yeah, I'm down. I'm totally down.
Most people go with full moon movies.
We're going to do Moonbeam.
Dude, Moonbeam.
So look out for probably Prehysteria and Remote and Josh Kirby.
Damn you, Josh Kirby. You're so amazing. Yeah. I actually haven't seen them, so hopefully they're good. Actually, I watched tape one. Wow.
They're fun. You're going to have a good time.
Yeah, there's some good stuff. But we'll be back. And happy Halloween.
Happy Halloween, everybody. It's the best day of the fucking year. Enjoy it.
And don't dress up as a sexy devil or cat.
Or blackface.
Or okay. He's got a better one.
Don't do that. It's never a good idea.
Yeah. I'm going to let Matt in with that one. Good job. Bye. Blackface.
Quentin's, everyone kind of knows how twisted he can be just from his past pictures. And yeah, he went all out on this one.
Oh, yeah. From Robert Rodriguez. From Quentin Tarantino. From Dusk Till Dawn.